So just before I start, just a quick introduction about myself. My name is Sumi, and I'm an engineering director with Dow Jones. Not sure how many people know what Dow Jones does. Do you know what Dow Jones does?
Yes.
So what
Instrument.
does Dow Jones do? Because
Is indexing, right?
no, it's actually not. That's the reason I asked that question. So we sold our index business about 4 years back. So now it's a completely subscription. Or a completely media company. We're offshoot of Fox, 21 Century Fox, News Corp, Wall Street Journal. So that's what the company publishes every day. And a lot of people read Barron's.com, MarketWatch. So if you read
Do you know Rajiv?
Rajiv.
Yes.
Is
So
that right?
I'm assuming you guys are from New York Times then.
Yes.
Okay. So I work with Rajiv very closely.
Oh boy.
He's just joined 6 months and we have had a good connect, especially he's very passionate about QA, so that's why. So anyway, without going further into that, so I just wanted to make sure you guys know that it's more Wall Street Journal than MarketWatch. It's a media-based company, not indexed anymore. So why, I just wanted to give a quick perspective of what's happening in the industry, right? Everybody's talking artificial intelligence. The reason for that is, we are moving in a very fast-paced world, right? Gone are those days where you want to do something tomorrow. Actually, now you want to do what you wanted to do tomorrow yesterday, correct? And artificial intelligence is coming way in a, it's a very big market right now. If you go based on the studies, people say that by 2020, the cognitive computing will save U.S. companies about $60 billion. Artificial intelligence is going to be huge for being a competitive edge in any industry now. If you want to excel in any industry, artificial intelligence is the only way to go. And that's because businesses are expanding so fast. So there, I think AI is now what we say is primed to propel into the insight. You want to have an insight into everything that the user is thinking. If you have not tried, go to inbox.google.com. And you'll be very surprised that Google actually reads your email, and then based on that, it has some suggestions already on the response. So if somebody's saying, "Hey, how about we meet tomorrow at 9 to discuss this?" You have an auto-canned response from Google which says, "Yes, sounds good. No, can't make it." So that's the use of AI that we are seeing everywhere. So why should QA not be part of that, right? So if you look at how it's helping industries, everybody, as I said, is a firm believer on saying that if we have that market intelligence on what our customers want, what the demands are going to be, we can support that faster. As I said, predictive analysis is big. How many times do you all go to Amazon and you already see five things that Amazon wants you to buy without you telling it wants? We are talking about self-ordering or auto-ordering of things that you always buy every month. It's kind of scary to a point. I was at a conference where we were talking about certain things that AI can do, and now there are talks on how do we curb what AI should be doing. How far is too far when it comes to AI, which is very interesting. So based on the fact that it's a very interesting topic, we at Dow Jones decided to say, how do we bring AI into quality engineering? So one of the things you will see during this conference or wherever you're going, the term QA is slowly kind of dissolving, right? Nobody's talking about something called quality assurance anymore. It's a negative connotation to it, which is not the right approach, but that's the reality of it. You saw somebody talk about a transformation where they are building in SDETs. I know New York Times is also doing that. But I don't think that will, at any, like, maybe it's not the right thing to say, but I don't think it will ever replace manual testers. It will ever replace a human being sitting in front of the computer. But we still have to be in pace with what the world wants, right? So when we all started, at least when I started my career 18 years back in QA, QA was always about defect detection. How do we find issues, right? And then a new era came where people said, shift left or transform QA functions to do defect prevention, right? So how do we build a QA organization which is preventing defects? Fortunately, unfortunately, as I said, world's moving fast. So now people want to be in a next level of an organization where they say, how can I do prediction of defects? Like, how do I know I'm going to have a defect in my system 2 days later, right? And it's a very interesting paradigm that's actually now happening, right? We were at some point of time and even now talking about 90% automation, 100% automation, but I think that the time is coming where, you know, instead of shifting left, you're actually first shifting right and then coming left. What I mean by that is, at least within Dow Jones, what we are saying is, let's stop, right? 90% automation is not a good measure of saying you're successful in your quality engineering function. So our mantra now is, less is more, right? How do I automate less, but still have a bigger impact, is what AI is going to come and help us with, right? We can be in a business of 90% automation because every company is going through agile transformation, things are rolling out too fast, so I cannot even afford to have more automation on my project. So how do I do less to have a bigger impact? And that's where we are starting to leverage some of the tools from companies like Infosys and others, which are kind of the differentiating factors right now, to say how do we do less of testing to have, for it to be more effective. And again, I don't think what I'm talking about is something that we all don't know as a testing community, right? We all have done risk-based testing. But again, we do this risk-based testing based on a human being's gut feeling at times, right? There is some science, but then there is also some art behind the risk-based. And AI is kind of taking away that art piece, I should say, which I'm not, I'm talking about AI, but I'm not a big fan of that. But no, the fact is that you cannot take the art piece of testing out, right? At the end of the day, AI is also only as intelligent as you tell it to be, correct? No systems are right now intelligent enough. And actually, that's the scary part. If the systems become intelligent enough to start doing things on their own,
self-learning,
you know, the world's, you know, that's why we talk about, Elon Musk is talking about putting some structure in place and saying some kind of a guidance around what's too much on AI. But anyway, so what we are doing at Dow Jones right now is like a continuous circle, which is more kind of, if you look at Agile, where you do design, build, develop, and test, and then deploy, our AI cycle is also kind of same, right? So we are learning from something, we try to make some sense of it. So for example, we have data input, which is our test cases, our defect stats or defect matrix or actual defects. We have log files, we have requirements. We're trying to learn through them and say, what can we do to make sense of you know, what's happening on the application, and then respond. So what I mean by that is, there is, say for example, what we did, and I'll talk a little bit more on the next slides, is we have a defect analytics tool. So we loaded data worth, all the defect data worth 2 years into this system that Infosys is helping us build. And that system is now kind of doing predictive analysis on that data and telling us that your weak areas on the applications are XYZ, right? So we are learning based on that data. But then, and based on that, we're making some sense of saying, okay, so now we know what our weak areas are. But AI will not be successful if we do not have an auto mechanism to respond. Like right now, the way we do things in QA or in automation is, we know our problems, we know our weak areas, that's the risk-based, and then we execute. But execution, the process of actually triggering that execution is still manual, right? Somebody's saying, today I want to run my regression suite. What we are trying to get to is, how can we auto-respond? Like, if we know enough today that our defect data from last 2 days is telling us that our current build is going to be having more issues around a certain feature, can we auto-trigger tests that are going to test that functionality?
in that case, you need the automation.
Yes, so we do need automation, but as I said,
but you are automating only that
portion.
You run the automation only for
that portion.
Part.
Yes. So we don't want to run the automation, like, it's not that we don't want to. Obviously, we will run the regression, but as I said, one of the common things that all of us as QAs face a challenge day in and day out is this much time and that much to do, right? And that reality in the agile world is also not changing, unfortunately. So we are trying to say, can we auto-trigger things that can help us detecting these things faster, right? So there is a kind of a circle that goes around, and what we are now trying to do, which we are in the initial stages, is take a look at our tools and the artificial intelligence, but then there is a constant learning that needs to happen every day. So we are building mechanisms where, like, otherwise you just load data over 2 years, you get some input, you respond, but if that loop is not continuous, then you'll regress. So we are, again, trying to use some machine learning tools here to do that. So what are some of the tools that we have? So one of the accelerators or the tools that we have is around clustering. And what does clustering help us do is, we all know, right, we keep writing tests. We have new features, we write new tests. And then you add certain things to the regression, but your test suites are growing bigger and bigger and bigger. And if we, and governance of that test suite is becoming challenging, right? The systems are getting so complex, it's not sometimes even possible for you to know, are you writing duplicate tests for things, right? But at least in our organization, we have that challenge where there are a lot of duplicate cases around testing for things. Some of them is also related to end-to-end testing. So we have a legacy backend system, and most of our testers test our services through that system, and then that system gets rolled to production, then the UI gets built. Now the UI testers are testing the same integration end-to-end, and so sometimes there is that duplicacy of them testing the same exact thing as these people are testing. And then there's a considerable overlap that we realize. So what the clustering tool does is, if you load all your test case data, which for us is in Jira, you can import it to an Excel, it kind of gives you that knowledge and says, these are test cases which are similar. So instead of running 100 test cases, the 50 that you run will still give you the coverage that 100 would have given, because 50 are on overlap. Obviously, we have, the regression suite is very big. The approach till now has been, there's a fix that needs to go to production today. Like, how many times do we go through that cycle where, even after a scrum cycle and a sprint, business comes up and says, I do not care, I want this tomorrow. Has anybody experienced that? So that's where Agile goes completely out of the door, right? And you can be in that. Because businesses are not mature enough, you can say, hey, we have a sprint cycle that's ending in 2-3 days, we'll give it to you in 3 days. No, right? That's never happening. So even after automated suites, they take time. We do have headless, for UIs, we do have headless execution. Even then, there are certain things that you do want to test on the real things, right? We've seen multiple instances where things do run fine on a headless browser, and then you off go on to an iPad and a Chrome, and then things start to break. So how do we give business that advantage? So this tool actually lets us figure out what is a good set of test cases that are either similar or duplicates, so that you do not do much same execution again. So we actually have, based on this tooling, broken down our regression suites into what we call it as high, medium, and low criticalities. So every time some change comes in, instead of running the whole suite, we are running the high level regression or high criticality application test that we run. So this tool is helping us with that. Obviously now, as I said, we are reducing the effort for automation because we have realized that over a period of time, even your regression, there are certain features of the app which are not touched, which do not have any defects. It's okay at that point of time to make a decision on not executing those tests, right? So we've got testing efficiencies. I would say that at least just by utilizing this tool, we realized at least 15% reduction in what we should execute. So if we were executing 100 tests before, we realized that at least 15% of what we are writing is a dupe or is kind of doing similar function than our other tests. So that's a big number, though it looks small. It's huge when it comes to execution. So that's one tool we use. And again, if you guys have questions, stop me.
Is it a license-based tool or a source-free?
So this is a license-based tool that we have through Infosys. They are helping us actually. So they have a base, and they're helping us build this tool now, based on our needs. So it's not an open source tool. Today, actually, whatever I'm talking mostly is not an open source tool that we have experimented only because we have a relationship with our vendor partners, and you don't want to invest into something, reinventing something.
But we make this kind of tool. Oh, don't use it for our
purpose. How frequently do you use the results? Like, so for 2 months of investigating and get the results from this tool, you invest, you say, okay, 15% of the test cases are not working, so just remove that from the screen.
Yeah.
And then only 85%. How frequently do you just monitor that?
So actually speaking, we are monitoring them right now at a monthly basis. So we are on a 2 week sprint. So every two sprints, we are trying to do this.
I was going to wait for my time. So this tool allow you to catch all the duplicates or redundant, whatever.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
How do you guys prevent people from introducing new redundancy into the repository?
So that's what I said, that every month we will run this,
we'll load the data.
You constantly. Yeah. And that's what I said, in AI, until you do this in a continuous cycle, you will not get the benefit because you will regress. Right?
Yeah,
so
but the people got to know not to do it to introduce the thing. This tool does not help.
So this tool does not give you a warning and say, hey, you're
writing
a duplicate test case. No.
Okay, it does not.
It does not.
Yeah.
Hopefully we'll reach on AI at that point of time where it will stop. But at this point of time, it not. And I don't think even after using this tool, you have 100% duplicate and similar test case identification. And that is because another challenge that we're trying to do is a very consistent way of writing test cases. Right? Unless you have a very standard mechanism of writing, the tool goes in and looks at common keywords, right? Common keywords, function areas, features, and then try to figure out if you're doing, for example, it reads the word login, and it reads the word, homepage, New York Times, just for example. Then it knows that this more likely is a duplicate test case, but it's very keyword driven. So if the people are not using a standard format of defining functions, features for which these tests are written, or are these functional tests, regression based, things like that, it will not. So I'm just telling you, this is like a disclaimer to say this does not guarantee 100% duplicate identification.
Precise or structured does all the data that you feed into it have to be? Because at the beginning you mentioned that there is a lot of sources,
mm-hmm.
like it's not only logs and not your test cases, which can be pretty much very well structured,
mm-hmm.
but it's also bug reports, there are also some like social
media
stuff,
yep.
Which is obviously plain text.
Yep.
So, how much do you actually constrain yourself, and how much do you actually have to train the people to write, I don't know, even the bug reports in a proper way, and always include enough like source materials with them to this, for this to actually be effective?
So actually, there are two parts to that problem that we need to solve. So one is we need to train the machine,
right?
Because obviously the machines only right now, there's only so much brain the system has. So that's one part where we need to constantly look at the results and say the machine did not identify this as a duplicate, but it should. Then to your point, we're also working with our test engineers to tell them on specific ways to write test cases. And I'm not saying in terms of the language, but it's more like a structure. Like we want them to know if it's a, are they writing this test case specifically for a browser, for a device, for a feature, certain things that they are trying to standardize. So it's a multi-pronged approach. You can't just either tell the machine to do learn everything, because then you start getting a lot of duplicates which may not be duplicate, and you don't want your test engineers to take the, all the burden of saying, now I have a very structured thing. You know how, what happens when you put a structure in place.
How do you massage the historical data to feed the system? Because it can be written in multiple ways.
Yeah.
It takes like a lot of effort just to restructure the old data, historical data.
Yeah, so we are in that process, as I said. So that's what is learning to teaching the tool.
I see.
So you load whatever data you load into the system, and we don't want to clear up historical data, because as you said, there can be thousands and thousands of test cases from last 2 years.
Right.
It's maybe easier to tweak the tool
to recognize.
So far, what is the difference if I filter in Jira and find all the test cases and figure out that this is duplicate or not, versus this tool?
So as I said, out of the box, we have 15% efficiency that I said are duplicate that we were not able to identify on our own. Again, just so you know, right, artificial intelligence is exactly what human brains are doing, right? But human brains only processing things now, versus AI is processing that on a continuous basis. So we are not able to identify 15% of test cases which are actually duplicates, but the tool is helping us do that. So the next one to that, right? So I think of all the things I'll talk about, the one that has been most effective for us right now has been defect analytics tool. And what does this tool do, right? So again, it's from Infosys that we are using. So in this case, the reason it's more successful because I can feed in structured and unstructured defect data. So I'm not doing any massaging of my data. All I did was went to Jira, took a dump of 2 years worth of things in an Excel, loaded onto a tool, and this tool runs through a data analytics and provides some insights into defect patterns. So it tells you, like I'm just saying, right? It tells you that of all your 5 releases, or 20 or 30 or 100 releases, you've always had issues with people doing something on an iPad, on a Chrome, for example, right? It also does some kind of a risk analysis. So overall, what you get from this tool is it gives you a behavior of saying your application always tends to do this, or these are the areas which always have problems. And again, those problems may not be completely technology-related problems. Some of them are people behavior, right? So a developer who tends to always write a buggy code, right? I'm not saying that. So it brings in some flavors of things which are sometimes very uncomfortable to talk to with people, because you suddenly realize that you've always had an issue with anything on an iPhone or anything on an iPad or anything related to a legacy integration. Like every time we integrated, we've had issues. So what was happening is that right now in a Dow Jones ecosystem, there is a, so we have a legacy system. We are trying to build all of that into cloud. That's increasing the complexity. And then we have, everything is very interconnected. The systems have been in place for 10 years. So nobody really knows the interlinking of what happens. So I'll give you a simple example. A person X on a team makes a change. He only knows that he impacts three people or three applications in an organization. Guess what?
More than three.
Right? And what's happening because of that is, so we've had multiple ways where a downstream system makes a change. We are all moving to microservices. Services have problems. So it's sometimes very easier to look at this data and say, every time we have built this new app and integrated with XYZ system, we've always had challenges, right? Some of them is because they made a change and never told us, which is very classic example you'll all hear, right? Sorry, I made a change, didn't tell you. Guess what? The user in production did. So that's the problem we have. So the need was that we have so many complex and interdependent systems, and as we are developed, so another initiative that I just want to quickly mention is what we are trying to do is create wrapper classes around our legacy APIs. And so the interaction is very multi-level. It's not a very clear front-end talking to an API database and off we go, right? We are multi-tiered to whatever level you can consider. Because now there's an initiative to write wrapper classes over our UIs too. So we did want to identify hotspots on the application. The other thing is, one of the systems that I work with is our e-commerce platform. That's the bread and butter, right? That's how we collect money into our systems. Any break into that is causing revenue loss immediately. Every minute that the system is down is a direct revenue loss. So we did want to identify hotspots because we had a very unstable system for 3 years where things were always, it was common to have things broken in production. To that extent. So also we wanted to make sure that based on this data, we make sure that things which are flaky in the past are tested before we test other things. So what has happened is, as a benefit of all this is, we are much better at managing our risk. It's all about risk at the end of the day. I think that's where I feel like QA's role is in an organization, is to how to help manage that risk to the product team. So we have been very successful and able to identify weak areas in the apps. One of the biggest thing benefit that we are now seeing that now the development team is very appreciative about is, based on this data, it's a very good feedback to the dev team to say, hey, we've done enough of patching of our code. Now it's time to take a deep breath and maybe refactor the code, right? So this is fundamentally what is driving our main focus on AI in testing, is for dev teams to have that focus on saying, you know what, every single release that you've done in the past, everything was good for 7 months, but past 2 months have been really brutal, and specifically in one part of the app. It's time to refactor, right? It's kind of making a decision to either refactor the code or look at the tech debt. Yes.
So how would you compare this to some traditional static code analysis tools?
So the difference between this and the static code analysis tool that we are seeing is, this is a constant learning loop. That's where I said the artificial intelligence has been different. This defect analysis is being done every sprint, correct? Traditionally, you will not have time to sit down and have somebody do that analysis and give it to you.
Well, you have tools for that, so you do.
Yeah. No, but I'm saying, so what, like, as I said, this is an automatic thing that we are able to process a lot more breadth of data into this tool. If you look, as I said before, AI is not fundamentally a lot more different than a human brain doing things, right? It's just the process of, can automation do the same thing as manual tester does? And the answer is yes, but can it do it with as fast speed as a manual tester? In some cases, not. In actually some cases, manual testing can be done very fast, much faster than writing automation, right?
Yeah.
So that's where the catch always is even here. But it's a little more helpful than doing a static code analysis for us for now. And again, this is more about QA going in. We are kind of producing this data and showing it to the dev teams. So it's been more helpful. But as I said, with this, we have been at least able to concentrate on things which are more structured, and we're able to provide that feedback to our dev teams, which is huge. And lastly, is the customer sentiment, right? So we are in a world where I don't even go to a restaurant to eat without going to Yelp, right? How many of you have, like, it's become reality, right? For every single thing you do, you go to a forum, you go to an app, you go to some place, and you figure out what's the rating of that place or the food thing or the thing you buy. Like, to a point, I think, you know, we'll probably stop talking to people unless you have a rating displayed on you. It says, I'm 4-star rating person, talk to me, right? So
move to China. That's already there.
Oh, it's already there?
Move to China.
So yeah, I was just reading about it, yeah. It's crazy, right? But what is happening is, in the digital transformation or the world that we are living in, patience, we are much more impatient than the generation maybe 10 years or 5 years back, right? You go to a place, you don't like the experience, done, right? You lose that customer. That's becoming a huge part, especially on the mobile app marketplace, because you do not even download an app until the reviews are good, or if you see one bad review, you are done. And just so you know, that when we did some analysis and figured out, for you to get one bad review and for you to overcome with that, you need at least 50 positive reviews to come up to get 1-star rating up. So if you get one star rating on an app, for you to make even for that, you need 50 good reviews. So you cannot expect things. So what we are trying to do, and again, this is part of the QE transformation that we are going through, or saying quality engineers are not just people who will test and be done. We're going to help with some kind of, you know, tooling that can help with customer sentiment analysis. So what this tool does, as it says, right, it keeps on going to all these Google apps, Play Stores, App Store for iOS, and try to figure out what kind of feedback we're getting from the users, right, and user feedback. On what customers need. As I said, right, people want, now we are at a place where what you're thinking about now is kind of stale after every few seconds.
You guys created this tool?
No, again, this is all
this
vendor.
This is a tool, right?
Yeah.
That is third party.
Yep. Again, very important for our product team, because what's happening is, as I said, when Rajiv came in some time back, to the organization, our ratings are not as great as we would want it to be.
So you use this tool to, like, estimate your QA efficiency or, like, overall company efficiency?
Overall quality of the product efficiency, yeah. Right? So, for example, if we start, like, I was just talking to the product team today morning, and they said, we're getting a lot of customer complaints about downloading our app on iPad. It's very slow, right? That's a good feedback to have using the tool and saying, hey, people have started complaining since last 2 days about downloading the app from the App Store. Or people have been complaining about battery usage or data leaks and things like that. So it's mostly around the overall product quality. It's not just contributing to QA efficiency per se, but it's the whole quality transformation where QE is part of the team. So, as I said, this is, you know, huge for the companies, where they are able to now do things. First, stop the bleeding. If you see there are issues in the app and your analysis tool is giving you that feedback or saying you started to get bad feedback after this release, there's introspection that needs to be done. And secondly, as I said, your users want something different all the time. Like, I would not use a single app if it just does the same thing In fact, you won't even go to a restaurant to eat if they don't have innovative food menus, right? So that's what is happening. How do we get to users giving feedback and saying, by the way, I would love to have a feature where I can pay by PayPal. Just giving a simple example, it's not being relevant here, but that's the feedback you're saying, oh, 80% of my customers are complaining about not having a certain payment method on my site. It's a good time to do that. As I said, feedback to the product team, because they are constantly doing their backlog grooming and the sprint planning and all of that, and they're looking for competitive edge. Some of the feedback on what customers want on the social media can directly feed into them designing things for the future. So that is huge. As I said, every product, everything is reviews important now. So this tool is helping us with customer sentiments. As I said, from our experience, since the time we started using this tool, we've at least improved our apps, mobile apps, ratings by 0.5. So we were at about 3.8 or so, and we're 4.3. And I think the recent release things have improved much significantly faster. So these are the three tools. There's actually a plethora of tools that are out there. There's a lot more people are trying to do in AI space, just not clustering and just not defect analysis. There are so many other things that companies are trying to do. I have a list. When I send this presentation out, I can include that.
That would be great.
Yeah.
So, so these are some big open questions that typically organizations which are going through this journey are asking themselves, which is like, does it take a transformative approach? So this is just like food for thought for people on saying, when you are trying to use some of this, these are some of the questions that come up in mind or being asked generally. They ask, people always are saying, is it just one big shot approach of doing a complete transformation of an organization, or can I do it piecemeal? Can I do an incremental approach? You can do incremental, and that's what we would always suggest. From a business perspective, they're always looking for saying, what problems can it solve and what problems it cannot solve? In terms of technology, you've asked questions on saying, is it an open source tool available? And the answer is yes. There are open source tools, and there are good communities of that are developing now.
That's especially around Python. So when you search around like Python tools and libraries, there's so many.
And that's where a lot of times we're also getting this question asked from our stakeholders saying, do we build this tool by ourselves or we just buy it? Or do we go open source? As I said, open source versus something that's coming through us, through our vendors. The biggest that you start hearing when you talk about AIs and organizations are now people are saying, what would happen when you free up my capacity? What happens to my job? Are you gonna downsize? So as a manager of a QA organization, that's a question that I always keep getting asked. What would happen? You're suddenly talking about freeing up 30% people's capacity. Are you going to let people go? And I think we just were in a session for that QA transformation.
Mm-hmm.
And they said they have 6 headcount, like not headcount reduction, but they have improved capacity by 5 or 6 people.